God of Abraham and Sarah, and all the patriarchs of old, you are our Father too. Your love is revealed to us in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of David. Help us in preparing to celebrate his birth, to make ready our hearts for your Holy Spirit to make his home among us. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the light who is coming into the world. Amen. Lord Jesus, you are the one who is to come. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light, now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal, through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first reading is a reading from Isaiah. The word that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountains of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to see it. Many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. The word of the Lord. The second reading is a reading from Romans. You know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer now than when we became believers. The night is gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling or drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said to his disciples, "About that day and hour no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of man. For as in those days before the flood they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise.
Please be seated. So today's gospel sounds rather end-timey, doesn't it? There are sudden, unanticipated, and unexpected disappearances. We have a reference to Noah and a previous time when lots of things ended unexpectedly. And I have over the years heard many preachers, generally not Episcopalians, who hold forth on the sudden disappearances and how we must do everything that we can to ensure that we and everyone else that we love are one of those who suddenly vanish. But I think that that is actually not the point of this reading or of the gospel. Because what Jesus is emphasizing here time and again is uncertainty. No one knows, no one, not the angels, not Jesus. Only God the Father knows. We do not know that day when the Lord is coming again. So be prepared. And it can be tempting, I think, to look at this passage from the gospel and think that, well, nothing we do actually matters. Why plan too much for the future when it's all going to end? Because look at Noah's time. All of those people getting married and assuming that they were going to have a future, and then everything gets washed away. It does seem to me like that line of thinking, though, also implicitly assumes that we can figure out when the Lord is coming, and that we have somehow cracked the code of the Bible, and so therefore we can be truly ready, and we can be ready in ways that our neighbors and everyone else can't be. But that also ignores what Jesus so pointedly says in the gospel today. We don't know. We can't know. All we know is that someday it will happen. We, as Americans, tend to be very forward-looking people. And I have been told to plan ahead for as long as I can remember. And so we do plan ahead. We plan for retirement, for kids' education expenses, for vacations, maybe even for the end of our own lives in the forms of powers of attorney and wills. And I'm not going to say that we shouldn't do this or that this is bad, because I have worked with many people who would not, or more often, simply could not, prepare for the future or plan for the future. So I do know how important it is for us to do these things, and we do need to plan ahead. But when we do that, we also realize that what we're doing is planning ahead, but also hoping for the best. Our plans may not turn out the way we wanted or the way that we expected. Things happen, things fall apart, our lives change, and therefore we adjust our plans accordingly. The only thing that is certain, the one thing that is always there, is uncertainty. It is impossible for us to plan and prepare our way out of every contingency. We do not know the future, and we do not know what will happen at the unexpected hour. So then what does it look like to be ready and to keep awake as Jesus says to do? How are we supposed to be ready when the Son of Man does come? I don't think it means that we are supposed to have set aside supplies or prayers or something similar so that we can survive that catastrophic moment when Jesus shows up. Being prepared is, and you have heard me say this many times before and we'll probably hear it many times again, it's really about how we live our lives. There is a difference between being a survivalist and being a Boy Scout. They're both prepared, but how they prepare and what they prepare for are really quite different things. We could frantically run around and store up things for when things fall apart, but in that case, nothing that we do is ever going to be good enough. Or we could make reasonable preparations, knowing that something can happen, and also continue to live our lives. Being ready is really about knowing Jesus, because how will we know that he is coming or that he is here if we can't recognize him? Again, it's about how we live, about how we pattern our lives after that pattern of life that Jesus showed us. It is about establishing that relationship with him, not just a me and him type of friendship relationship, but also a relationship with Jesus as embodied in the community, in the body of Christ here. Being a Christian is not an individual endeavor. Today is the beginning of Advent and the start of a new church year. And usually we think of Advent as the time where we wait and we prepare for the coming of Jesus as a baby born to Mary. But the readings that we hear over the next couple of weeks remind us that Advent is also a season of preparation for when Jesus will come again. We can prepare by taking maybe a sort of survivalist approach, or we can prepare by getting to know Jesus better through the scriptures, through prayer, through service, and through the life and support of this community. The gospel today tells us to be ready, but what Jesus does not say is stop everything. So we should continue to live, to marry, to raise families, to care for each other, and as it's going to happen in just a couple of minutes, to bring new members into the body of Christ through baptism. We plan for the future, but we also know that we don't know what the future holds. Our hope and our trust is not in the end in our own plans, but it is in Jesus and in the knowledge that he will come again. That trust and that hope are what will allow us to be ready, even at the unexpected hour. Amen. So we have a baptism this morning. We have Elizabeth Sexton is going to be baptized, and as is the custom and tradition in this parish, I invite anybody, you know, kids or just kids at heart, to go to the back of the church to the baptismal font, and if you want a more close view and to see what really goes on for a baptism.
So we talk about being prepared, and I left something behind in the sacristy.
Nice.
The candidates for holy baptism will now be presented. All of you. Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?
I
do. Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? And for all of us, this is on page 303 in the prayer book. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support this person in her life in Christ?
We will.
Let us join with she who is committing herself to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. So starting on page 304. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe
in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of the Lord, who is conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered and was crucified by the Holy Spirit. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers? Will you persevere in resisting evil and wherever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
Will
you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
Will
you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being? Let us now pray for Elizabeth, who is to receive the sacrament of new birth. Deliver her, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
O Lord, hear our prayer.
Open her heart to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill her with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep her in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach her to love others in the power of the Spirit. Send her into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring her to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your Son, Jesus, received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death,
By it we share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Elizabeth, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Elizabeth, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in Christ's name. Oops. Do this right. You are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen.
Amen. Receive the light of Christ. Parents and godparents, this light is entrusted to you to be kept burning brightly. This child of yours has been enlightened by Christ. She is to walk always as a child of the light. May she keep the flame of faith alive in her heart. When the Lord comes, may she go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. Amen. Let us welcome the newly baptized. And so together we say, we receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection and share with us in his eternal priesthood. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Yes. Oh, congratulations, peace. Please be seated. So just a couple of announcements. If you have not yet turned in or returned your stewardship letter to Bob, please do so. That helps him and the vestry with determining the budget for next year. There were a couple of pictures that were left on the St. Paul altar after All Saints Day. Those are now at the back of the church on top of the altar case. So if you have a picture that you haven't picked up, please go get it from there. Do we have any birthdays today? Any other birthdays or anniversaries? Is this okay? O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Jen as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen her trust in your goodness all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So one other note. I mean, clearly, as you notice, we had bagpipes to start today. And there is a reason for that. It's, you know, we're wearing kilts, but the Episcopal Church actually has a connection to Scotland. And it's not just that many of us are of Scottish descent, or that we like tartan, or because bagpipes are amazing, even though they are. But actually, it goes back to the very start of the Episcopal Church as a church here, as an independent church in the United States. So if you take a look at our flag or at our Episcopal shield, you'll notice it's white. There's the red cross that makes up the bigger part of it. That's the cross of St. George. It refers back to our roots in England. The cross of St. George is the English flag. But in the upper left-hand corner in the canton, you'll see that there is a light blue section, and there are nine crosses in the shape of an X. And so a white X on the light blue background is the flag of Scotland. It is the cross of St. Andrew, the patron saint of Scotland, and we're actually commemorating the day, St. Andrew's feast day, a couple of days early. Falls on Wednesday this year. But the reason why we have that is back at the time of the Revolution, and my apologies to those of you who have heard this story either in the newcomers class or in the on the Thursday morning group, but we did not have a bishop here in this country. There was actually no bishop in the colonial era. There was no bishop after the Revolutionary War, and for a church that's name comes from the episcopacy, that was a problem. And the church in England would not ordain an American because no American could take an oath of allegiance to the king as defender of the faith and all of that. So they thought, well, what are we going to do? We need bishops here. And they, a couple of people got together, one of them being Samuel Seabury. And they realized, well, you know, there's also this independent Scottish Episcopal Church. It's not the Church of Scotland. It's not the Presbyterians. It is a separate church. It is an Episcopal church that has a prayer book, but it is not part of the Church of England. So they went over to Aberdeen. Samuel Seabury was consecrated by the Scottish bishops to become the first bishop of the Episcopal Church of the United States. So that is one of the reasons why we commemorate that in our cross, in the flag, and in the shield. And then there's also another part. The price, essentially, of them consecrating him as a bishop is that the church in the U.S. had to follow the Scottish prayer book, especially when it came to the Eucharistic prayer. So there's a part of it called the Epiclesis. It's where we ask the Holy Spirit to come down upon the gifts. That's when I do this over the bread and the wine on the altar. So that was in the Scottish prayer book. It was not in the English prayer book of 1662. And the Scottish bishop said, you must have that in your prayer book. You must follow our example. So for all that we like the 1662 prayer book and for how beautiful it is, actually our tradition comes from Scotland and not from England. And so for that, that is part of our connection to Scotland. Here ends the history lesson. One last point for anybody who is visiting here. When we do communion, we have the host, and Tim is going to show you. We have a little couplet as well, which you can choose. I mean, in our theology, you can have either just the bread or you can have the bread and wine, but either or will give you the full benefit of receiving the body and blood of Christ. Host.
Father will come along with the host, yep. And you may take that, and I will follow with the couplet. In the couplet, in one end, is also a small host, and on the other end is wine.
And in the Episcopal Church, all baptized people are welcome to receive Holy Communion. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is a right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of his new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Andrew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we have the final blessing, I realized that I forgot to thank our pipers. So thanks to John Elliott and to Brian Gray for piping us in this morning. It wasn't Brian Gray, I'm sorry. Murphy, yeah. Wrong Brian. May the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life. Amen.